Welcome to the Cisco Netacad Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Module 3, Part 2 of 2. Reference models. The benefits of using a layered model is that complex concepts such as how a network operates can be difficult to explain and understand. So for this reason, a layered model is used. Two layered models describe network operations, OSI and TCP/IP. The OSI has 7 layers, the TCP/IP has 4 layers. Over here on the left-hand side, we have the OSI model. You have physical, data link, network, transport, session, presentation, and application. And on the TCP/IP model side, we have network access, and you can see that encompasses the first two layers of the OSI. You have internet, transport, and then application, which takes the top 3 layers of the OSI and combines those. Now, continuing the benefits of using a layered model, there are benefits of using a layered model in that it assists in a protocol design because protocols that operate at a specific layer have defined information that they act upon and a defined interface to the layers above and below. It fosters competition between products from different vendors that can work together. It prevents technology or capability changes in one layer from affecting other layers above and below. And it provides a common language to describe networking functions and capabilities. The OSI reference model is 7 layers, as I said previously: physical, data link, network, transport, session, presentation, and application. You will need to memorize this in this course and in networking and beyond. And if you take the networking A plus certification, if you take this, and I think it's in the security plus, certainly in the Cisco certifications, it's in the other certifications and other areas as well. You need to memorize the OSI model for the reference model here. It's 7 layers. How I do it, and it's a mnemonic that I use, please do not throw sausage pizza away. And what I do is when I go into an exam where I need to memorize this information and recall it, I will write down PDNTSPA and then write out the words. And I just remember in my mind, please do not throw sausage pizza away. And then I can go through and say physical, data link, network, transport, sessions, presentation, application. I write all that out, and then I can then write all the details about each one of them that I can remember. Such as the physical layer describes the means to activate, maintain, and deactivate physical connections. This is where our medium operates, such as cabling, Wi-Fi signals. Data link is layer 2. It describes methods for exchanging data frames over a common media. That's layer 2, as you'll see a lot of times with switches. Layer 3 is the network. It provides services to exchange the individual pieces of data over the network. That's layer 3. Usually routers operate at the layer 3. 4 defines services to segment, transfer, and reassemble the data for individual communications. 5 provides services to the presentation layer and to manage data exchange. 6 is presentation. It provides for common representation of the data transferred between application layer services. And 7 contains protocols used for process-to-process communications. Next, we're going to take a look at the TCP/IP reference model. It is 4 layers. It simplifies a little bit from the OSI model in that it combines. We have 4 layers here: network access, internet, transport, and application. The network access controls the hardware devices and medium. Internet determines the best path through the network. Transport supports communication between various devices across diverse networks. And 4, application represents data to the user, plus encoding and dialogue control. Now, when we compare these two, as we've seen earlier, we have the application on the TCP/IP model encompasses the layers 5, 6, and 7 of the OSI model. The OSI model divides the network access layer and the application layer of the TCP/IP model into multiple layers. The TCP/IP protocol suite does not specify which protocols to use when transmitting over physical medium, and OSI layers 1 and 2 discuss the necessary procedures to access the media, and the physical means to send data over the network. Data encapsulation. We have to segment messages on the network to make sure they go through properly. So segmenting is the process of breaking up messages into smaller units. Multiplexing is the process of taking multiple streams of segmented data and interleaving them or winding them, putting them together through the network. So those are 2 terms that you're going to need to know for this course. The first one is segmenting, You need to know that term and what it stands for. And multiplexing is another term you need to learn. So segmenting messages have two primary benefits. They increase speed. So large amounts of data can be sent over the network without typing up. Hit fast forward to there. Increases speed. Large amounts of data can be sent over the network without tying up communications link. Increases efficiency. Only segments which fail to reach the destination need to be retransmitted, not the entire data stream. Now, sequencing is the process of numbering the segments so that the message can be reassembled at the destination properly. TCP is responsible for sequencing the individual segments. So if user one here and user two are both sending messages along the network, they get meshed together, but they're all numbered according to their destination and sender, so sender and receiver, and they're all numbered based on that, and then they can all be put to back together on the other end. Now, protocol data units. Encapsulation is the process where protocols add their information to the data. At each stage of the process, a PDU has a different name to reflect its new functions. There's no universal naming convention for PDUs in this course. The PDUs are named according to the protocols of the TCP/IP suite. So PDUs passing down the stack are as follows: data stream, segment, packet, frame, and bits. And there's a graphical representation here of that. Here's an example of an encapsulation. It's a top-down process. So the level above it does its processes and then passes it down to the next layer. And then that process adds its information to it. And as it all the way gets down to the layer one, and then it sends it across the medium. And then on the other side, it de-encapsulates it. And that's where we have our example here. Data is de-encapsulated as it moves up the stack. So the information is transmitted across the network. It gets on the other side. It reads all the ones and zeros. And if we're talking about the OSI layer, layer one receives it. Layer two and layer three passes it on up. And then it de-encapsulates it. And you have your data stream, segment, packet, frame, and received as bits. Or received as bits, and then frame, segment, frame, packet, segment, and data stream. Data access. Addresses, both the data link and network layers use addressing to deliver data from source to destination. So the network layer source and destination addresses are responsible for delivering the IP packet from original source to the final destination. And the data link source and destination addresses are responsible for delivering the data link frame from one network interface card to another network interface card. So if you are just using NIC cards, that's the data link source. And the NIC, this is our routing. This is where we do our switching area, so it's going to stay on the same local area network. And this is where, at the layer, it's going to get routed and sent out, and it's going to use IP addressing. Now, layer three logical addresses. The IP packet contains two IP addresses, the source and the destination. The source IP address is where it's coming from. The destination is where it's going to. And these addresses may be on the same link or remote. If they're on the same link, if they're on the same network, they just get sent using the layer two. But if they are on a remote network, they use the IP addressing and they get routed across some type of routing device. And it uses the IP addressing at that point to send it where it needs to go. An IP address contains two parts, a network portion, IPv4, or prefix IPv6. The leftmost part of the address indicates a network group which the IP address is a member, and each LAN or WAN will have the same network portion. And host portion, IPv4, or interface ID, the remaining part of the address identifies a specific device within the group, and the portion is unique for each device on the network. So if we look at this here, when devices are on the same network, the source and destination will have the same number in the network portion of the address. So for example here, PC1 has 192.168.1, and the FTP server has 192.168.1. Those are on the same network. They just have different host portions, but their network portion is the same, so they're on the same network. And that's where we get into subnetting. With the V4. Now, the role of the data link layer addresses is the same IP network. So when devices are on the same Ethernet network, they're on the same local area network, the data link frame will use the actual MAC address or machine address code address of the destination NIC. So these are two terms you need to know, MAC and NIC, machine address code and network interface card. So the MAC addresses are physically embedded into the Ethernet NIC and are local addressing. The source MAC address will be that of the originator link, and it's going to be a hexadecimal code. When the network interface cards are created, the whoever is creating those, whoever is creating those network interface cards will be given a hexadecimal code to put on there and then a unique code. So there's a unique hexadecimal code to whoever created it and then a unique code within that manufacturer. So the source MAC address will be that of the originator. The destination will be that of where it's being sent to. Now, when we go to a remote network, that's what happens when we're the actual destination is not on the same LAN. We have to do some routing, and that's where we use the IP addressing. So when PC1 tries to reach the web server, so PC1 here tries to reach a web server, but it's not on the same local area network, well, it can't use its MAC address anymore. It has to use the IP routing or IP addressing for routing. So then the routers use the IP addresses. They send that through to the web server. Even though the MAC address is still there, it's only using the IP address to routing. Now, the role of the network layer addresses, when the source and destination have a different network portion, that means they're on different networks. So here for 192.168.1 and then web servers 172.16.1, those can't see each other. Even though their connections are all connected together, they can't see each other because they're on different portions of the subnet. When the final destination is remote, layer 3 will provide layer 2 with the local default gateway IP address, also known as the router address. And the default gateway is the router interface IP address that's part of the LAN, but it'll be a door or a gateway out of your local area network. And then all devices on the LAN must be told about this address or the traffic will be confined to LAN only. If you're not given out a gateway address, it won't be able to be routed anywhere. So once layer 2 on the PC1 forwards to the default gateway, the router then can start the routing process of getting the information to the actual destination. The data link addressing is local addressing, so it'll have a source and destination for each link. And the MAC addressing for the first segment is this hexadecimal number. These are fake numbers here, but it'll be hexadecimal on there. And then while the L2 local addressing will change from the link to link or hop to hop, the L3 addressing remains the same. And since data link addressing is local addressing, it will have a source and destination for each segment or hop of the journey to the destination. So the MAC addressing for the first segment is source PC1 and then sends the frame and the destination to the router gateway and sends it through. The MAC addressing for the second hop is the source first router exit interface, sends the frame, destination second router receives frame. And then the last segment is the second router exit interface, sends the frame, and then the web server NIC. So it changes, it updates it as it goes along. Now notice that the packet's not modified, but the frame is changed. So therefore, the L3 IP addressing does not change from segment to segment like the L2 MAC addressing does. The L3 addressing remains the same since it's global, and its ultimate destination is still the web server. Some of the things we learned in this module are rules. Protocols must have a sender and a receiver. Common computer protocols include message coding, formatting and encapsulation, size, timing, and delivery options. Protocols, they send messages across network. To send a message across the network requires the use of several protocols. Each network protocol has its own function, format, and rules for communications. We talked about protocol suites. Protocol suite is a group of interrelated protocols, and TCP/IP protocol suite are the protocols used today. We looked at standards organizations, and again, I encourage you to go out on and do some research on standards organizations. Open standards encourage interoperability, competition, and innovation. We took a look at reference models. The two models used in networking are the TCP/IP and OSI model. The TCP/IP model has 4 layers, and the OSI model has 7 layers, and you do need to learn both of those. Data encapsulation. The form that a piece of data takes at any layer is called protocol data unit or a PDU. There are 5 different PDUs used in the data encapsulation: data, segment, packet, frames, and bits. And I'll almost guarantee you that you're going to see that on an exam or a quiz. So you want to make sure that you understand that. And then data access. The network and data link layers are going to provide addressing to move data through the network. Layer 3 provides IP addressing, and layer 2 will provide MAC addressing. And the way these layers are handled will depend on whether the source and destination are on the same network or if the destination is on the different network on the source. Okay, this has been Module 3, Part 2 of 2. I hope it's been helpful for you, and I hope you have a great day.